So we're here on this wonderful September day with Terry Lyons, and she's going to share with us some artifacts from her family history.
Going through some of my family archives and some of the antiques that my mother left me, one of them is my great-grandfather's chair. This chair dates back to the late 1800s, perhaps the early 1900s. And it was where he sat many evenings, smoking his pipe and conversing with my great-grandmother, who sat in this chair. This was my great-grandmother's rocker. And many a night she sat in this chair and told my mother her stories as a slave when she was a child. You know, during the Depression, it wasn't like it is now. You can have permanent press clothing or take them to the cleaners or just shake them and wear them. No, you had to iron them, not with the regular iron, but the flat iron. Some of you who may not be familiar with that, this is when we had the old Franklin coal stoves, and the iron had to be heated on the stove. And usually they put a little mutton tallow or goose grease to keep it from sticking to the clothing. Beeswax was really good so it wouldn't stick. And this is the way they ironed their clothes. Nothing was automatic. Nothing at all. You went in a cup of coffee, you know, you put your little grounds in the machine and boom, you have coffee. No. In those days, people bought the bean, the whole bean, and put it into a grinder. And this is the way they ground their coffee. The knob is missing, but the coffee came out through this little drawer. And that was the fresh ground coffee. And from what Mama told me, it was delicious, full of flavor. You only needed a little bit. A little bit took you a long way. Many people didn't have electricity. And so to make it through your way in the house, particularly if you had to go out the house after the sun went down. This one is a little, well, it's seen better days. But this here is an idea of the kind of lanterns that people carried in the dark to find their way home, and in some cases to find their way around the house. It has a chain that's attached to it. So, you see, it could hang and provide light. And this is what life was like around the turn of the century. Persons who sat in these chairs, my great-grandfather, his name was Shedrack Williams. He was born a slave. You can get this or not. He was born a slave in Westmoreland County, Virginia. Don't know much about him except for the fact he was born on the Williams Plantation and he passed away in 1924. And his wife was Luella Fulcher, born and raised on the Fulcher Plantation in Westmoreland County, Virginia, baptized on the Rappahannock River. And both of them came north to Gwinnett, Pennsylvania in the 1880s with the help of the Quakers. It was this woman who raised my mother. It was this woman who told my mother all of the stories of slavery and what it was like during that time. And it was my mother in turn who told me about the Depression era, about making the soap and ironing the clothes. And she kept my great-grandmother's legacy, my great-grandmother's spirit alive in me. Although I never knew her, I know her. And that is the beginning of my family history.
And this is in the book that you wrote entitled, What My Mama Said, What Mama Said?
Yes, it's in the first book entitled, Let Me Tell You What Mama Said. Okay. It is available on Amazon. It is also available on Goodreads.com, or you can go to Lulu.com mm-hmm. and purchase the book.
Yes. Great. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.
So, Terry, tell me about your Aunt Ella.
Aunt Ella. She was my grandmother's sister, and she lived in Ambler, Pennsylvania. She was a fastidious woman. She was up at the crack of dawn, and she washed and ironed and cooked and cleaned, had a house full of children, but she ran that house like a well-oiled machine. But Aunt Ella was something. She used to have a name for just about everybody in Ambler. And she'd see people walking down the street, she would have expressions like, well, here comes Clark Gable and Carol Lombard. Some of the most ridiculous looking couples she would attribute to movie stars or big entertainers from that time. Aunt Ella, as time went on, of course, she became ill. She fell. She broke her hip. I believe she had a series of strokes. And her eldest daughter had to take care of her. And eventually, Aunt Ella had to live with her eldest daughter in Germantown. So as the daughter was caring for Aunt Ella, she went through a series. You know, when a person is about to transition, you can see where their body slowly shuts down, and sometimes you can see them go through things that you wouldn't ordinarily see in a person. Aunt Ella had a bout where she began to purge, not vomiting, so to speak, not with food or even with any bodily fluid, but she purged what was some kind of substance, black substance, that came out of her system. Now, from what my mother and my cousin said, they believed that her body was purging, that her body was cleansing and preparing for transition. You see, because my family always believed that before you leave this earth, you have to purge all your sins, all of your dirt, all of your transgressions will purge from your system in preparation for you to transition to the other side, to even be fit to go onto the other side. You understand? And this is kind of what happened with Aunt Ella. But in her heyday, she was a fantastic woman. She had a name for everybody. She talked about everybody. But she was a fun-loving woman who, at the end of her life, had to cleanse herself to get ready to cross over to the other side. Mama used to always tell me, you know, Terry, you're not going to like everybody. And everybody's not going to like you. And there's nothing wrong with that. But leave them alone. Don't go and start trouble and going to put stumbling blocks and obstacles in someone's life because you got a mind not to like them. Because if you do something like that, up the road is waiting on you. And the life you save may very well be your own. Mama saw people who deliberately did aught to other people because they didn't like them. And why they didn't like them, still don't know. They didn't like the dress they wore. They didn't like something they said. They didn't like the attitude they had. Sometimes the dislike was really nothing more than just jealousy. And because of that, they figured they had the right to bring drama and turmoil into these other people's lives. Oh, but before they laid down and died, they went through some serious changes. Mama always warned me about that. She always warned me about how the people you did wrong may be the very one to come and give you a pot of soup at the end of your journey. Ain't it something? Be careful. Just walk away. Leave them alone. My great-grandmother passed away when my mother was only 17 years old. And that's when Mama had to leave Gwinnett and move to Ambler and room with whoever would allow her to stay with them. But in that situation, Mom, this is where Mom found how people can be so mean. You know, the old saying, nobody wants you when you're down and out, is something that rings true and something that my mother, among many people, lived. You know, if you have to come to me for a place to stay and something to eat, and you have no other means to survive but through me, I can abuse that and do anything that I want. I can put my foot right up your behind. And what are you going to do? Where are you going to go? And Mama lived that for a few years until she was able to establish herself. Now that occurred right after the war, maybe the early 50s. Later on, around the 60s and the 70s, when those people who treated Mama so mean They're old now. 65, 75, somewhere around there. Mama saw how they suffered. Mama saw how it came home to them. And this is why Mama warned me, if you don't have any good blood for somebody, to leave them alone. Don't do them wrong. Because Mama saw the suffering of people who did wrong to other people. And sometimes the folks may be dead and gone. It's 40, 50 years. Maybe you even forgot all about it yourself. But up the road is still waiting on you.
So Terry, tell me about this fabulous antique lamp.
This lamp belonged to my great-grandmother, Luella Fulcher, the picture that you saw earlier. It was an oil lamp, and far as I know, it came from approximately the 1880s, maybe the 1890s. It has the original oil well right here. I can't really get it open. Mm-hmm. And here is the wick turner. You could turn the wick mm-hmm. right here. My grandmother had it converted to electric back in the 40s or the 50s or something. So now all I have to do is pull the chain mm-hmm. and I have my great-grandmother's beautiful oil lamp.
Beautiful.
She would sit by her oil lamp with her rocker nearby, and she would have my mother, because my great-grandmother was totally illiterate. She couldn't read or write, but she had my mother read the Bible to her just about every evening. And this is a 1901 version of the King James Bible. Now it's a little, it's frail, so I'll go easy with it. But this Bible was what was used in Bethlehem Baptist Church at the time, that was located in Penland, Pennsylvania. And this was the Sunday morning Bible. This was what got them through prayer. I found this in the garage. It had been put away for many, many years. And cleaning the garage, I came across this Bible, and I was just absolutely stunned that not only do I still have it, but that it's in, well, reasonably good condition. This was the King James Bible.
Thank you.
Yes.
So, Terry, you have a few more antique pieces to show us?
Yes, just a couple more.
Mm-hmm.
This chair to my left belonged to my grandmother.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not sure what era this came from, but I do know that this is all hand-done tapestry that my mother and my grandmother both thought was so wonderful, was very beautiful and very proud of. It was a chair that no one was allowed to sit in.
Mm-hmm.
It's what they called a conversation piece.
Okay.
You know, and after my grandmother passed, you know, my mother had it and she kept it, and now it belongs to me.
Mm-hmm.
This table to my right is a marble top table that has, you can tell a lot of times by the footing of a piece where it comes from, where the era it comes from, or who made it. I'm not sure who. I don't know if it's Chippendale, if it's Duncan Thiepe, or which person it came from, but it is a very lovely old table that my mother has had since the early 1940s, and it was given to her by a family member. So these are some of the lovely old pieces that I still cherish
mm-hmm.
and to keep my family alive and going.
So I understand you have some lovely 78 records to share with us.
Yes, I find myself listening to my mother's collection that she began in the early 40s, just prior to World War II. And I love to listen to them. I love old jazz. And this is a sample of Lionel Hampton's tune entitled Central Avenue Breakdown.
All right.
This is when the Savoy Ballroom was hopping, the home of Happy Feet.
This is when Ridge Avenue and Columbia Avenue had it hot.
Thank you for sharing.
Anytime.
Okay. So Terry, you were telling me about your parents having a band. Tell me about that.
Yeah. It started in the late 50s. My dad began as a sideman, what they used to call a sideman, with the Mickey Collins band. So he would play guitar with Mickey Collins and then sometimes some other bands that were in the city. Live music and bands were very popular during that era, the late 50s, early 60s.
And you have some of their music you can share with us?
Yes, this is a tape, not sure when or where, but I would guess the early 70s of the Benny Lines Band.
Your dad.
This is Dad. He's lead guitarist.
And your mom is the lead singer.
Mom was lead singer.
But not on this piece. There's no singer on this piece.
No.
Okay, we'll catch her voice later.
Yeah. See, you had the reed section. Then you had that strong rhythm section. This was when live music was good. When popular music was good and good music was popular. You can see the people out there on the dance floor, can't you? In their tucks and gowns. And they're bopping and slopping all over the floor. Dad stood strong and proud, holding his guitar. And the band was carrying it on. It was heads up, professional, all night long. Yeah, this was a good time. Dad had a thing he used to do with his guitar. He could do many tricks with his guitar. He bought this Fender approximately 1964. And this was his prize piece. His Fender guitar.
Wow.
Now, Dad had the little plugs and wires to make to put into the amplifier. Mm-hmm. But he also had a piece called a Leslie. Mm-hmm. I have it downstairs, safe and sound, put away. And with that Leslie, he could hook up the guitar to the Leslie and fiddle with the buttons however kind of way he did. And he could make it sound like a guitar. He could make it sound like an organ. He could make it sound like almost any instrument he wanted.
Wow.
And in addition, he had the wah-wah pedal, what they used to call the crybaby. That was very popular in the early 70s when Shaft first came out and everybody was with the crybaby, the wah-wah. You see, so Dad had a lot of fun with his wires and plugs doing all kinds of creative sounds.
The Benny Lyons Band.
The Benny Lyons Band. And he would get on that lead guitar and send the people sailing. You know, Mama began her adult life in North Philadelphia. And she did what they called sleeping in. Sometimes she did day's work, but then other times she would sleep in. She would sleep in with the family and take care of them. Well, people who did sleep-in work only had 2 days off. That was Thursday and every other Sunday. They used to call Thursday Potslinger's Day. On this particular Potslinger's Day, Mama went out with a friend to a club called Cavaliers that was located in Ambler, Pennsylvania. Well, in the meantime, my father had just come north from Durham, North Carolina. So happy to be in the north. He was working at a place called Doofus Hospital that was located in Jarrettown, Pennsylvania. Well, a friend of his asked him to go out for the evening. Well, as it turned out, it was a blind date. And that's how my mom and dad met. And one of the first dances they had together was Billie Holiday's You Go to My Head. Yeah. they were really taken by each other. Both of them were lost sheep. It was them against the world. Later they moved to, they got married in 1948, and they settled in North Philly. As time went on, both of them had a love of music, and our dad would play his guitar. Mama played piano a little bit, but she definitely sang. As time went on, they began their band. Dad began his lead guitar band. Later on, Mama began to sing. And this was Dad's second career and Mom's first career. It was loaded with music and loaded with beautiful people. Thursday night rehearsal right here in this house was almost like a block party within itself. I have Mama on tape here singing one of my favorite songs from 1972 movie Lady Sings the Blues. Mama is singing Good Morning Heartache. We're going to give a listen right now. My appreciation for music began. One thing I want you to understand about the dynamics of live music. Take a song like Good Morning Heartache. Thursday night rehearsal. My father would only have, say, perhaps the reed section of the music. First and second alto, first and second tenor trumpet. That's it. And I would listen to those notes come together. Just first and second alto for 16 bars, over and over again. First and second tenor, the same thing. Then you would hear that come together. And then that next week at rehearsal, the rhythm section is backing up that reed. And I tell you, when you hear it come together, it is chills right up and down your spine, across the top of your head. Because I heard it being built. I understand the discipline that it takes to create those perfect notes. This is why it's a shame to let live music die. Live music is music of the soul, music of the spirit. We cannot ever let it die. Ballroom is filled with beautiful couples across that dance floor. Under the shadow of dimly lit chandeliers, a beautiful night, a beautiful affair. I'm
All right. Yeah. Is that a picture of your parents right there? Can you bring it over?
Oh.
That's fine. Let it roll.
Okay.
Music sounds good.
This is my mom, Hazel and Benny Lyons, out at an affair somewhere, enjoying themselves.
That's great, Terry. Thank you so much for sharing your family history.
Oh, you are most welcome.
And your books tell us all about what all this means to you. How many books have you written so far?
I've written 5 mm-hmm. so far. And my history is based in the book, Let Me Tell You What Mama Said, and that's available on Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
When I go into some of the music and the career of my parents, that book is Take It From the Top,
okay,
which is also available on Amazon.
Okay. Terry, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right.
I was in my mother's break front, and I came across some lovely things that belonged to my great-grandmother, one of which is a glass from the Trenton State Fair, 1910. See that? My great-grandfather bought it for her and had her name inscribed on it, Ella Williams.
Beautiful.
Yes. And he got her a
salt and pepper shaker.
I just have the salt shaker here that says mother, and there it says 1910.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that something?
Yes, beautiful.
This mug is from Atlantic City.
Mm.
And it's difficult to see, but it says 1904.
Wow.
Atlantic City.
Isn't it nice?
Yes. These are just other mementos from my family that I cherish so much.
Just red glass, huh?
Yes, it's red glass. I don't know if it's a low actinic or exactly what it is, but it's absolutely lovely.
Mm-hmm.
To my wife, and he,
beautiful.
Shadrach gave that to his lovely wife, Ella.
All right now.
Yes. Just a little more of the Williams collection.
Thank you.
You know, it's
so, Terry, you found a scrapbook from the 1940s. Unbelievable.
Yes, it is. You know, it's something when your old folks pass on, because you come across things that are just mind-blowing. I have a picture here of Paul Robeson.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like the lady's name may be Ruby Elsie.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not sure of the era,
because
for some reason, this scrapbook doesn't have too much of a date. But I would say this is around maybe World War II.
Mm-hmm.
There's a tribute to a picture of Louise Beavers from that time.
An actress.
She played the character Beulah for a period of time. That was a popular television show in the early 1950s.
Oh, okay. Wait a minute. I'm sorry. I thought we were looking for somebody.
Jack Johnson.
Oh, Jack Johnson.
Yeah. There's Jack Johnson there, shaking hands or doing something. Maybe
tying
his neck.
Somebody's,
what's he doing?
Boxing glove on.
Boxing glove. Yeah. Yeah, and here's the beautiful Marian Anderson. Isn't she a queen?
Mm-hmm.
And here's an even more gorgeous picture.
Mm-hmm.
And see, now that's a lady.
Mm-hmm.
Her elegance makes such a statement, doesn't it?
Right. Her father didn't really want her to be in the public eye like that.
No, he didn't. But boy, we would have missed out on something beautiful if she hadn't have done what she did.
This is Benny Goodman?
Yes, in the center is Benny Goodman, and to the left is Lionel Hampton in his early days, and Teddy Wilson. You know, Benny Goodman took a chance on bringing 2 black guys into his band during that time, but he used them, he took a chance, and gave them a chance.
He kept them on recordings for a while because in the studio, nobody knows if they're black or white.
Mm-hmm.
And it took a while before he brought them onto the stage to perform with him.
Now, who is this colorful character?
Oh, Heidi Hi.
Heidi, Heidi, Heidi Ho.
Yes, Cab Calloway.
He the king was, of Heidi Ho.
He was the man.
So staying at the Cotton Club 6 months is no new experience for the king of Heidi Ho.
Isn't that something?
Look how thin he is.
Yeah. He's a young man there.
Look at those shoes. Wait a minute. Wait. Let me see these shoes. Wait a minute. I'm sorry. They have like a lady's heel on them or something.
Oh, yeah. Something like that. We have to get someone to help us.
Look at those pants.
Understand the model and style of that time.
Oh, that's fabulous.
Isn't that something?
Thank you so much.
You are so welcome. My great-grandparents, Shedrack and Luella Williams, they left Virginia, Westmoreland County, Virginia. They came up to Gwinnett, Pennsylvania about 1885. They ended up on northbound 202, which was a dirt road during that time. Well, my great-grandfather worked and mama farmed and they did laundry for the white folks, and they were able to save enough money finally to purchase their own home. And they bought their home on Sweetsford Road in Gwinnett, Pennsylvania, about the early 1900s. Well, as time went on, my great-grandfather passed in 1924. My great-grandmother passed in 1942. But there were cousins who kept this air property together. So when I came along, I would go up there for Sunday dinners and the Easter Sunday and little family gatherings. And I was in that old house that belonged to my great-grandparents. And it was a beautiful home. It was simple, but it was quaint. And it personified the architecture of that time. The tall, skinny windows that went almost from ceiling to floor. The narrow panel strips of the molding in the house that were just about waist high. And I really do believe everything in that house had to be at least 100 years old. But when you walked out of the back porch and you looked at the expanse of the land, you could see the beautiful open fields that was once a farm. You see, they farmed to keep themselves together. That's how people were able to survive during difficult times, because they were able to feed themselves off the land. If I looked out onto the other side of the property, I could see almost clear to 202, mm-hmm. which was right off of Sumneytown Pike.
Mm-hmm.
And Mama took me on a tour one time to show me where the old outhouse used to be, and the artesian well. So it was a beautiful landscape, and inside the house was, you could tell that it was just a very well lived in family home.
Now, we don't have the property any longer, I understand.
No, the property was sold in either 1980 or 81.
But what we do have are these tax receipts. From
yes, we do.
1935. $6.75 road tax, $15 school tax for 10 miles, $4.50, which tax is this here? County tax. Okay, so that's 1935. Then in 1942, $6.75, went up $3, $18 now for the school tax.
Can you imagine?
Okie dokie.
And how difficult it was for them to pay that.
All right. And then in 1949.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
Yes.
$10.50. It went up again.
It went up again. Went up.
Okay. $33. That went up.
Yes.
School tax went up.
Yes.
Okay. Now this one is going down, it seems. What's going on? They're splitting it out or something?
Well, if the you notice, 1942...
County
was
tax.
During the war.
Oh, right.
And 1949, we're now in post-war.
Okay.
And so the economy, I would think, had changed substantially. So like here in the Depression, here is during the war, and here is what I think would be the onset of the post-war boom.
Okay, so it's the county tax that changed.
Yes.
Across here.
Yes.
Okay, county tax, 450, split out. Oh, they split it. Okay.
Yes.
And they split it. Now it's down to even less. Mm-hmm. Wait, right here. 188.38. And what year is this?
1949.
Yes. Now 1950. Isn't this something? Wow. Yes. And you have other documents over there, important documents. We don't need to see all those.
No, they're just more tax papers. But these were the significant ones.
Oh, I think that's so interesting. Yes. Thank you, Terry.
Yes, you're very welcome. You. Yeah.
Now, this is your mother's first grade picture.
This is my mom, first grade. This is little Hazel. She was Hazel Johnson at that time. And this is her cousin, Dorothy.
Mm-hmm.
And as you can see, they're the only two children of color in the first grade class.
Mm-hmm.
This school was called the Springhouse School, which is now a part of Gwinnett Mercy College, located on Norristown Road in Springhouse, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have this picture in my book under the caption, before Brown versus the Board of Education.
Mm-hmm.
1931, 1932 is when this picture takes place.
Mm-hmm.
And as you can see,
mm-hmm.
my mother and her cousin integrated that school.
Mm-mm-mm.
Yes.
Okay.
After Dad began his band, he was passionate about bringing good music to his people, and he was passionate about having excellent arrangements for his book, what they would call his music book. And that would be his variety of music. So Dad would handwrite. He could listen to a record, and he would write out each and every note for every song for each musician. Now, a lot of this music was written with a fountain pen. And this is when you had to fill the pen up, remember that, with the well? And he would carefully write out each note. Now, from the looks of this here, this would be for his bass man, because he has the different keys and the channel in which to play. But if you go a little further, we've only just begun. Oh my goodness. Here in pencil, Dad is writing out an arrangement for a song. I'm trying to get a good one. Three Times a Lady. There's one. Three Times a Lady. And this here is an arrangement for the trumpet. And he would handwrite that out, the entire song for the trumpet. And he would do the same again for first and second tenor, first and second alto. And he would have the entire arrangement prepared for Thursday night rehearsal.
And now we have Finale software where you just do it with a click of a mouse.
Isn't that something?
It's wonderful.
Yes, just with a click of a mouse. But here you had to work for
them. That's right.
You had to work for it. Trying to see what else is in here. Something with the title, please.
We have to open it.
Yeah.
Here.
Oh, here we go.
Back in Love.
Back in Love.
That's alto sax.
Yes. Alto sax.
Well, thank you so much, Terry.
Yes.
Well, it's thank so you. Special.
It is.
This book is entitled I Shall Not Want. And it is a diary of a love story. I've told you about the history of my mom, who was brought up by her grandmother, who was a slave in the trials and tribulations of coming up during the Depression, and of my dad, who came to Philadelphia right after World War II, the wonderful career of music that they shared together and they shared with me.
I love my mom and dad so much. They were my best friends, and I was theirs. I'm all they had, and they were all I had. And as time went on, and Mother Nature and Father Time coalesced in their bodies, they began to need care. My father began to suffer terrible from dementia, and then eventually blindness from glaucoma. My mom began to suffer from congestive heart failure and other different issues. They didn't have anybody to take care of them except me. Now, unfortunately, I had to place my dad in a nursing home because he was just too big to handle. And anyone who's dealt with someone suffering from dementia knows how difficult handling those people can be. But I was able to take care of my mom. I took care of my mom the same way she took care of me. And my purpose in life at that point in time was mothering my mother. And there was nothing sweeter, there was nothing more honorable than mothering my mother. Mama became so ill to the point where I had to choose between taking care of my mother or keeping my job. And I was blessed by the Most High to be able to choose to take care of my mom. In the book, I discuss all what I went through in looking at after my dad in the nursing home, taking care of my mom at home, and then trying to hold down my job for a bit. And in the interim, I was still writing, I believe it was my second book. Later, my father was so ill that I knew he only had a few days, perhaps maybe a week to live. But within that week, mom became ill and was placed in cardiac ICU. That was the darkest week of my life because there was something inside of me where I felt, is it possible that they could both leave me at the same time? And not having any brothers or sisters, I didn't have anybody to turn to. It was a dark and lonely week of my life, and it wasn't nothing but Father God that got me through it. My mother was discharged from the hospital on Saturday, and my dad passed away Sunday. And again, through the darkness, through the grief, and through the mourning, I was able to take care of my mom, make arrangements to bury my dad. And then, not having time to grieve my father, I poured everything I had into my mother. It was 7 months, almost to the day later, that I lost my mom. I went to bring her breakfast and discovered her body in bed. By Christmas of 2010, I didn't have either one of them. But through that grief, through the mourning, through all that I had been through, beyond exhaustion, when I thought I didn't have any more to give, I finally had peace. The transcendence was beautiful. I knew I did everything I could. When your conscience is clear, you can write a beautiful story, you can have beautiful memory, and you will always have beautiful love. And that's what I captured in I Shall Not Want. Through it all, I never wanted for anything.